we need to prove that for this maximal ideal, which is just any maximal ideal, there is some gamma for which m is equal to this m gamma. Okay. Suppose m is not a subset of m gamma for all gamma belonging to the closed unit interval. We start off with this supposition. What we are supposing is that the maximal ideal m is not contained in any m gamma. Okay, that means for any gamma in this closed unit interval, there will be at least one element in m, at least, which are nothing but functions that is not in m gamma, and that's what precisely we are going to do now. For every gamma belonging to 0, 1, we choose an element f gamma belonging to m minus m gamma. The fact that this choice depends on gamma is denoted by putting a subscript gamma with f. Okay. So then next, what we get from this? Now note that f gamma is after all in the ideal m. So if I multiply f gamma with itself, the multiplication being the ring multiplication, right? Multiplication of two functions. Keep in mind that the multiplication we have in this ring is not composition of functions. It is just pointwise multiplication. If we have two functions, say g and f, then their product is defined like this. At any point x in 0, 1, the value is this, product of their values at x, that multiplication. Okay, so now f gamma is in m, so its square will also be in m, since m is an ideal we have f gamma square belonging to m. Also f gamma square gamma is not equal to 0. Why? You see, f gamma square gamma means what actually? By the definition of multiplication, this is f gamma of gamma square. Now, since f gamma does not belong to m gamma, so its value at gamma cannot be equal to 0, because those type of functions are in m gamma. So that means f gamma of gamma, this is a real number, right? This is not equal to 0. So its square will be positive. Or I should have written this stronger condition. This is positive. Fine. Now we are going to use the fact that f gamma is continuous at gamma. Since f gamma is continuous at gamma, or f gamma square, because product of two continuous functions is continuous. I think it's better to write there, is continuous at gamma there exists an open subset u gamma of 0, 1. Keep in mind that u gamma is open in 0, 1. So it's not necessary that u gamma will be open in R, because it's open in the subspace topology. For example, this half open interval is not an open set in R in the standard topology, but this is open in this subspace. Okay, so in that sense u gamma is open in this, such that f gamma square of u gamma is a subset of this. What have we written here? You see, if you think of the situation in terms of graph, this is 0, 1. F gamma square is any continuous function. The thing is that at gamma, which may be any point here, F gamma, the graph lies above x-axis. So since the function is continuous, there will be some open set there is an open subset of this. Containing gamma such that the F gamma square image of U gamma is entirely, it consists of only positive real numbers. So in this small region, the values are all positive, and this is happening because of continuity. If we don't have continuity, say if the graph was broken at gamma, okay, then we could have had something like this. So no matter how small an open interval or an open set you choose containing gamma, the left hand side for those values of x, the values will always be negative. Now that is not the case. On u gamma, say this is u gamma, the values are all positive, and that is happening because of the fact that f gamma square is continuous at gamma and is positive at gamma. Okay. So note that for every point gamma in 0, 1, we have got an open set u gamma containing that point gamma. That means if we collect all the u gammas, then this will be an open cover for 0, 1. This is an open cover in some topology books. They use the term open cover ring, same thing, open cover for 0, 1. Now we use the non-trivial fact that since this is a closed bounded interval in R, it is compact. Since is compact in the standard topology, that is understood. So that means finitely many such sets will cover 0, 1. So there exist gamma 1, gamma 2, up to gamma n in 0, 1, such that this is contained in u gamma 1 union u gamma 2 union u gamma n. That is, they cover, finitely many of them cover the space. Okay. Now, let F be the map. F gamma 1 square plus F gamma 2 square plus etc. gamma n square. Keep in mind that since these are ring elements, we can add them up, and that will give me again a ring element. So this is again a function in our R. But what is the something special about this function is there. Okay. Now, recall that all these F gammas we have chosen where? See, F gamma belongs to, according to our choice, M minus M gamma. So, irrespective of the value of gamma, F gamma is in M. So, that means F gamma square is also in M. In particular, these squares are also elements in the ideal M. And since an ideal is an additive subgroup, their sum is also in M. Since F gamma 1 square, F gamma 2 square, F gamma n square, they all belong to M, we have F belongs to M. Now the thing that, now we have to show that F actually never becomes 0 on 0, 1. For any, say we take zeta belonging to 0, 1, there exists gamma I, where I varies between 1 and n, such that zeta belongs to u gamma I. Why? That is because they cover 0, 1. So this point zeta will be in some u gamma I. Then F gamma I square of zeta will be greater than 0. Because you see, all such, if we apply that on u gamma, and since this belongs to u gamma I, so F gamma I square will be positive. Since on u gamma I, so in particular at zeta also it will be positive. Now look at this function. It does not matter what happens to the other values, the other functions, what the other functions do to zeta, that does not matter. We have one positive value. The others, whatever they are, they cannot be negative. At most they can also be, at most they can be zero, some of them. But if ultimately has to be positive at zeta because of this. This implies because all are squares, there is no question of things getting cancelled, that will not happen. So this implies f of zeta is greater than 0. That means f never vanishes. Thus, the reciprocal one by f belongs to R, because you see, if a continuous function never vanishes, then its reciprocal is also a continuous function. Okay, from results in analysis or calculus. Thus, the reciprocal is in R. Hence, okay, now f is in the ideal M and 1 by f belongs to R. So, their product will be in M since M is an ideal. Hence, the constant function one equal to f times 1 by f belongs to m. Keep in mind that this one is the unit element in the ring of functions, which is nothing but the function that maps all the elements of this closed unit interval onto the number 1. So it is the constant function 1, not the number 1. Okay, but since the unit element belongs to m, so m will have to be equal to the ring by that first exercise. This implies m is equal to R, which contradicts the hypothesis that m is maximal, because a maximal ideal by definition has to first of all be a proper ideal, it cannot be equal to R. And this contradiction is arising from our supposition that m is not a subset of any m gamma. So our supposition is wrong. That is, M is contained in M gamma for some gamma belonging to the closed unit interval. Okay. Now we are going to use the fact that M is a maximal ideal. Since M gamma is maximal, this we are getting from example 5.3.2, because all M gammas are maximal, we have proved there itself. Since M gamma is maximal, M gamma is not equal to R. Since M is maximal, we must then have M is equal to M gamma. So that is because maximality of M implies that M gamma is either equal to M or equal to R. But since M gamma is maximal, this is not possible. So the only possibility is this. And that's what we wanted to prove. So this ends the solution. So now the maximal ideals in the ring of all continuous functions, this ring, we have found them totally, and they are precisely the M gammas. For each point in the closed unit interval, there is a maximal ideal. So with this set of exercises ends. The next thing we are I mean after 5.3 we have 5.4, and this involves the what is that thing? There is an if we are given an integral domain, then we can construct a field in which that integral domain can be embedded, much like how the ring of integers can be embedded in the field of rational numbers. That can be done generally for any integral domain. And at the end of this section, we will come across something called there is a problem which leads to the idea of, I think it's called localization in algebraic geometry. We will see those things, okay. So with this, I end this video. If you are new here, please subscribe to my channel. This is me, Lucifer, signing off from a mathematical room. Have a nice night.